Hey everyone, Professor Dave here. I want to talk a little more about nucleophilic substitutions, specifically the SN1 reaction.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So the SN1 is another nucleophilic substitution reaction, so it's similar to the SN2, but there's a couple key mechanistic differences. So let's take a look at what's going on. The first difference here is that it's a two-step reaction. So I know that's confusing, SN1 being two steps and SN2 being one, but once again, it's about the transition state of the reaction. So let's see here. So the first step is that the leaving group leaves. So this is prior to any contact with the nucleophile. This carbon is able to lose a bond to this chlorine. Chloride is very stable by itself, and we have a carbocation intermediate here. So one key thing to understand is that we're going from a sp3 hybridized tetrahedral carbon to an sp2 hybridized trigonal planar situation here, because this carbon is losing an electron domain. So now that this carbon with a formal positive charge has only three electron domains, it is going to have trigonal planar geometry. So basically, this molecule is a plane perpendicular to the board. We're looking at it edge on like this. So now that we have the carbocation intermediate, the second step is for the nucleophile to attack. So here, let's say it's just a molecule of water solvent is going to go ahead and attack here, and we'll have a water molecule attached, and then another molecule of water will go ahead, snag that proton, deprotonate, and we have just the alcohol left. So one very important part about the SN1 mechanism is that because the carbocation intermediate is trigonal planar, that means that a nucleophile can attack from either side. Remember that anytime we have a reaction occurring, it's because something is dumping electrons from its highest occupied molecular orbital and putting them into the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital. And in this case, if we have this trigonal planar situation here, the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital is the unhybridized remaining p orbital. So these are sp2, and then the unhybridized third p orbital is each lobe extending in this direction perpendicular to the plane of the molecule. So that means that water can attack from this side, or water can attack from that side. And if you are generating a chiral center, you are going to get something called a racemic mixture. Of enantiomers or of stereoisomers at that location, which means in 50% of the resulting molecules you'll have an R stereocenter, in 50% you'll have S. So that's definitely something to be mindful of. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials, and as always, feel free to email me with questions, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.